Hello there, Gamerinos and Gamerinas. Welcome to Unigore Storm. This is Rady, and today I present to you a Spooktober special episode of Is the Xbox Game Pass Ultimate Worth Your Hard-Earned Candy? And today's game is, of course, Back 4 Blood, a fast-paced, cooperative zombie action shooter with lots of blood and gore and teamwork. The game is Left 4 Dead in all but name, which is alright because Valve hates the number 3, so there would never have been a Left 4 Dead 3. So yeah, characters and monsters are called differently, but it's essentially the same game. Zombies are now ridden, tanks are tall boys, okay boomers are exploders, and stalkers are still stalkers. The survivors are now called cleaners, and instead of just escaping, they try to help the last few people survive this apocalypse. They are immune to the zombie plague, and each of them has their own personality and starting loadout. The game has you playing through a campaign that's divided into a bunch of smaller stories that has the cleaners travel from safe room to safe room, accomplish different tasks before they have to fight or escape a massive horde of zombies. And of course, if you need to blow off some steam, you can just switch teams and try to eradicate humanity as a special infected. So yeah, if you already liked Left 4 Dead, this is the game for you. The game did evolve from Left 4 Dead, though. The game now comes with a lot of customization, and I'm not talking about weapon skins and outfits, though, of course, these are also here. I'm talking about loadout and abilities. So every cleaner has their personal starting weapons as well as an unique ability, like a bigger inventory, better defense or offense, and the like. Some characters are stuck with a melee weapon, others are more flexible. But then there are these cards. As I already said, a mission is divided into multiple parts, with safe rooms functioning as checkpoints. At every safe room, you can pick a card from a random hand that can increase your stats, or give you an additional inventory slot, or a special ability. While every additional card benefits you, to really get the most out of it, you have to take into account the character you're playing as and your team's composition. The sharpshooter doesn't need the ability to heal with every melee kill, and the healer doesn't need a bigger ammo pouch. At first, you only have a starter deck, but by playing the campaign or the swarm mode, you get points to acquire more cards. There's also a bit of randomization when it comes to the missions. The level layout is always the same, but enemies spawn in randomized locations. Previously open doors can be barricaded in later runs. Some special doors require tools to open them, and those tools don't always appear in a mission. It doesn't lead to too much variation, but it can be quite fun to find a new secret stash in a level, and it really sucks when you fuck up and don't get a second chance to get those goodies. Which just adds to the fun. Special infected also spawn in randomly. You can have a run where you only have to face a handful of them, and sometimes three tall boys just gang up on you. I also had an exploder spawn in when I turned a corner, so he was right in my face and I couldn't really do anything to escape. So yeah, the randomness can sometimes lead to a sudden unfair death, but mostly just increases the chaos on screen, which is what it's supposed to do. Instead of a number of rather short, movie-like missions, this game tries to flesh out the world a bit, having the campaign to be more connected and building on each previous mission. And instead of just choosing a level from a list, the campaign, well, all the game modes and options are now contextualized in your outpost. There you can walk around camp, visit the shooting range and talk to the other survivors and your superiors, I guess. You could just select everything from the menu, but if you're here for the immersion, you can walk up to one of the scouts and offer him resources to secure supply lines, which nets you cards to add to your deck. You don't have too much control over which cards to acquire, but you can at least decide what set of rewards to get first. You can also create different card decks to have different specializations for each character or mission type. But the meat of the game is inside the cooperative campaign, or the swarm mode. Other than in Left 4 Dead, this game doesn't feature a zombie mode for the campaign. All the ridden, regular or special ones are controlled by the AI, which does well enough most of the time. So you can't screw over other players that are just trying to progress in the story. To balance this out, the ridden got some reinforcements. I already mentioned the recurring, well, more or less recurring adversaries. There is another durable and hard-hitting special zombie, there's another exploding and slow-moving special zombie, there's another quick and far-leaping special zombie. Well, there's three of each type this time. The tank class now encompasses the tall boy, the crusher and the bruiser. The exploder class includes the wretch, the exploder himself and the reeker. And the assassin class zombies consist of the hawker, the stalker and the stinger. The class itself defines the role of each special zombie in combat, but each one has their own special skills that work in synergy with the other zombies. And depending on what combination of special ridden the cleaners are facing, they have to adapt their tactics. Though some combinations are more infuriating than others. The hawker can pin down players with a sticky projectile, and the wretch can vomit all over the cleaners to slow them down. In addition, every time a cleaner gets hit, their movement speed decreases down to a crawl, so that they can't just sprint away from a horde. So having multiple movement-impeding special ridden appear simultaneously can get pretty infuriating pretty fast. To make it worse, the exploder, bruiser and tall boy can push a survivor around with their powerful attacks and the stalker can drag them away. So pretty much every special ridden can disrupt the cleaner's positioning. This can lead to tense but high octane combat or to a quick party wipeout. And that's still not all. There are more minor special ridden that stick to the wall and pounce on you when you pass by, or ones that alarm other ridden to your position. There are crows that draw in a horde when startled, or alarms that can go off. There are even giant boss ridden. Not all of those are playable in swarm mode, but they still add even more variation to the run and gun and scavenge gameplay to not let it go stale. Most of the time, this game offers a really good time, at least as long as you're playing with other people. You can play the campaign on your own, with a team made up of bots, and I guess it is an alternative to playing not at all, but if you want to use tactics and build your character around these, you have to play with other people. You can just create a game or jump into a quick game, and since this game allows for crossplay even between console and PC, you shouldn't have to wait too long to find a group. The most fun, though, you'll get out of playing with friends. That's what I did. I'm not really interested in playing the campaign with randos, but that's just preference. There are enough options for everyone here. There's also a competitive horde mode. There you have to survive for as long as possible in a small arena while a team of player-controlled special ridden as well as infinitely spawning regular ridden try to kill you. And to make it harder, and to have a natural time limit, there's a swarm of zombie insects that draws ever so closer. Kinda like the blue zone in PUBG and similar mechanics. After a few minutes, the cleaners will unavoidably die, and then the teams switch their roles. The former cleaners now play as the ridden and torment their opponents. To win a match, the second cleaner team has to survive longer than the first. That means the first cleaner teams defines the winning condition for the second team. If they die before the timer runs out, the first cleaner team, now the ridden, wins. This is repeated a number of times on different maps until the final winner is decided. It's quite fun and a better and more reliable way to get to play as a ridden than it would have been as the invader in a campaign. It would still be a nice addition to have a competitive campaign mode. Maybe in a future update? So as it is right now, the game is a lot of fun. There is still a lot of jank to find, some runs can get borderline unfair while others are a breeze, and while playing with friends we had some issues with the netcode. But for the most part it was fine. This game needs, and supposedly will get, some additional work, and Turtle Rock have already announced that they will add more content to the game over time. So that's good to hear. I'm not sure if the game is really worth $60 as it is right now, but if you happen to have a Game Pass subscription, this would be a great addition to your library. And I also think that if you're interested in the game and don't have a subscription, well, now's the time to get one. There are a lot more really good or unique or at least interesting games in the Game Pass library, some of them featured on this channel, so I'm sure you'll find at least a few ones worth playing. And since the game is cross-platform, you can get it on Game Pass and play it with friends on other systems or services. So there's really no drawback. And with that, I bid you adieu. Have a horrifying day. That's it from Rady, and I hope to see you again on the next game.